Good evening, I'm Mehdi Hasan. I want to start tonight by telling you the story of an incredibly successful American immigrant who's been facing months of attacks and smears from Republicans. And no, I'm not talking about Ilhan Omar. Meet Pakistani-American Dilawar Sayed. He came to the U.S. for college, graduated from UT Austin with his bachelor's, and later graduated from Wharton with his MBA. An impressive pedigree. Sayed went on to become a prominent entrepreneur in Silicon Valley, running a host of companies related to software, AI, and healthcare. He was so successful, in fact, he became a government liaison. You can see him a little blurred there on the right, and later helped campaign for Hillary Clinton in 2016. If you don't already sense where this story is going, Sayed was selected to officially enter public life this year when the Biden administration nominated him in March to be the deputy administrator of the Small Business Administration. It's the climax of a real American dream story, right? But Republicans love creating nightmares for Democrats. See, there's nothing controversial about Sayed, except perhaps the fact that if he were confirmed to be the deputy head of this small domestic agency most people don't even know about, he'd be the country's highest-ranking Muslim. And that, depending on who you are, might be a bit much. For months now, Sayed's confirmation process has been stalled in a Senate committee because Republicans literally won't show up for a meeting when his nomination is being confirmed or considered. It's happened four times now. Senator Ben Cardin, who chairs the committee, Democrat of Maryland, has said their reasons for boycotting the vote, the Republicans' reasons, are constantly shifting.
There has not been an articulated reason why this person should not be confirmed. And, Mr. President, I know we've had this debate on nominations that are here on the floor, and we're wondering why people vote against them. I can't even get a vote in our committee on this because the Republicans won't show up for a vote.
The most prominent attack has been helmed by Republican Senator Josh Hawley, who's baselessly accused Sayed of being involved in an anti-Semitic organization. Hawley issued a statement in June blasting Sayed for sitting on the board of Engage Action, an advocacy group that's criticized Israel's policies and occupation. Hawley called Engage anti-Semitic for calling Israel an apartheid state. I wonder what he'd call the former Deputy Attorney General of Israel, who said the same about Israel in October. Then in July, Hawley corralled seven of his colleagues to write a letter to Cardin again, questioning Sayed's ties to the group. It's a ridiculous accusation against Sayed and Engage. I've spoken at Engage events, and as someone who's repeatedly called out anti-Semitism in America, and especially in the GOP too, I know that Engage isn't anti-Semitic. But don't take it from me. A host of major Jewish organizations have come out to defend Sayed, including the American Jewish Committee, which issued a statement not only citing Sayed's positive ties to the American Jewish community, but writing that even though AJC often disagrees with Engage on matters related to Israel, its advocacy is done in the great American tradition of respectful public debate. The irony of Josh Hawley, by the way, accusing anyone of anti-Semitism is not lost on me. The attack doesn't stick. And maybe it's for that reason that Hawley and co have launched another attack, another criticism, now claiming that they won't confirm Sayed until the SBA, the Small Business Administration, recovers money it gave to Planned Parenthood under COVID PPP funds. In an email to USA Today, White House spokesman Chris Meagher reaffirmed their commitment to Sayed's nomination and said Republicans should stop with the gimmicks and show up to work, and that small businesses would benefit from Dilawar's experience at a critical time. The Republican boycott of Dilawar Sayed's confirmation is itself an important story, but it also comes at a time when you have Republicans like Lauren Boebert and Marjorie Taylor Greene making horribly offensive, Islamophobic, anti-Muslim comments against Congresswoman Ilhan Omar.
It is time for the Republican Party to actually do something, to confront anti-Muslim hatred in its ranks and hold those who perpetuate it accountable.
It also comes at a time when more than 400 congressional staff members, including 50 Muslim aides, signed a letter to House leaders saying Boebert's comments have heightened the climate of Islamophobia on the Hill, creating a feeling of anxiety and fear for Muslims. And this heightened feeling of anxiety seems to be echoing across America. Under Donald Trump, hate crimes went up against Hispanics, Black people, trans people, Asians, Jews, and Muslims alike. But if anyone thought the xenophobia and undertones of white supremacy were gone, I'm sorry to break it to you, it might have left the White House, but it's still very much around. In a moment, I'll speak to Democratic Senator Tammy Duckworth, who sits on the Small Business and Entrepreneurship Committee. But first, I'm joined by lawyer, author, activist, and a friend of Dilawar Sayed, Qasim Rashid. He's also host of The Qasim Rashid Show on Sirius XM. Thanks so much for joining us this evening. You know Dilawar Sayed. Are you surprised at how brazen and ridiculous this series of allegations against him have been from the GOP, from Josh Hawley?
No, I think anyone who's followed how the GOP has functioned, this isn't surprising. Senator Risch on the Small Business Committee even called out his fellow Republicans for being obstructionists, but he's one of the people being obstructionist to these nominations. And I want to emphasize that not only is Dilawar the quintessential American dream, an immigrant who came here, contributed to the community, built phenomenal companies, created jobs, but by denying his confirmation, all the GOP continues to do is hurt small businesses, hurt working families, and create even more difficulties for small businesses trying to recover from this pandemic. And that's the clear message here. The GOP continues to hurt small businesses more than anything, and that needs to stop.
Qasim, is what's happening to Dilawar Sayed part of the same story that we've been seeing with Ilhan Omar and the racist Islamophobic attacks against her by GOP members of Congress like Lauren Boebert and Marjorie Taylor Greene? Is it all part of the same effort, the same campaign on the right to basically drive Muslims and especially Muslim critics of Israel out of public life?
Absolutely. And I think when you look at the attacks on Dilawar due to him having some advocacy for Engage, which, by the way, is a civil rights organization designed to increase Muslim civic participation. And you saw the massive response, conservative and liberal Jewish organizations, a multi-faith, multi-ethnic, multi-racial coalition of organizations from across the political spectrum came out in defense of Dilawar. And it just demonstrates how detached the GOP is from America as a country, from the American public. The vast majority are firmly behind him, including the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, because they recognize that he is a very special leader who can, at a very difficult time, uphold the needs of small businesses. But unfortunately for the GOP, the anti-Muslim bigotry and the Islamophobia is dominating their basic requirement to show up and do their jobs. And, you know, we're not even asking them to vote for him. We're simply asking them to show up so there's a quorum so there can be a vote.
It's amazing. Not just to show up. Don't even vote for the Muslim guy. We know what the GOP is, and you make the point that they're out of touch with American opinion. But, you know, in the Senate, you don't have to be in touch with public opinion. It's a minoritarian institution. You're a Democrat, though. Let's talk about the Democratic Party. You ran for office in Virginia in 2020. Why is your party, the Democratic Party, not taking a tougher stance against anti-Muslim animus? Why are they not doing anything to censure or remove committee assignments from a Lauren Boebert or a Marjorie Taylor Greene? Already had her committee assignments taken away. But I just feel like even within the Democratic Party, Islamophobia, okay, they're not the ones peddling the brazen Islamophobia that we're seeing from the right now, but they're not exactly standing up very loudly against it. Has it been normalized across the political spectrum in America?
Well, I think you bring up a good point. I mean, look, there have been some Democrats who have been outspoken in their condemnation of Islamophobia. Senator Tammy Duckworth is a great example of that. Certainly Senator Tim Kaine, Congressman Eric Swalwell. There's been some great examples of leadership. Speaker Pelosi has led the way on this as well. But I agree. There needs to be more done. Let's be clear. If there was an anti-Semitic attack, it would be rightly and resoundingly condemned, as it should be. If this was a homophobic attack or a racist attack, it would all be categorically condemned without delay. Tragically, in this point in America, Islamophobia is one very acceptable form of bigotry championed by the right and not condemned strong enough on the left. So my admonition to my fellow Democrats is treat this just like you would treat anti-Semitism or homophobia or racism, because it is as bad and as destructive. And Mehdi, as you pointed out, these anti-Muslim hate crimes are at record highs, not by accident. Part of it does come from allowing this bigotry and not condemning it strong enough.
In fact, Congresswoman Ocasio-Cortez just pointed out this week that if Lauren Boebert gets away with this stuff, you will see more hate crimes. You will see more Muslim women in hijabs who look like Ilhan Omar being attacked on public transit. That is the, you know, words have consequences. Qasim Rashid, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you so much for your time tonight. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
So, coming up. Qasim mentioned Senator Tammy Duckworth. On the other side of this break, I will speak to Democratic Senator Tammy Duckworth, who sits on the committee that's trying to confirm Dilawar Sayed. We'll also talk about Islamophobia and anti-Asian hate crimes in America, and about the filibuster, of course. Stay with us. 60 seconds. Welcome back. We've been talking about the Biden administration trying to confirm a Muslim nominee and being blocked by Republicans in the Senate. Dilawar Sayed's nomination to be Deputy Small Business Administrator has been met with a barrage of smears and false accusations. Earlier, I spoke with Senator Tammy Duckworth, who sits on the Small Business and Entrepreneurship Committee and co-sponsored the anti-hate crime bill earlier this year. I spoke to her about this stall nomination and about the Senate in general. Senator, thanks so much for coming on the show tonight. You met with Dilawar Sayed, this nominee, last week. He tweeted a photo thanking you and others for continuing to support him. Are you surprised at all that a non-controversial nominee for a relatively low-profile position is being treated like this by the Republican Party?
At this point, I'm not surprised. If you'd asked me this 9 months ago, I would have been surprised. But there's been this consistent, and I'm going to say it, very racist approach to nominees of color coming out of the Biden administration, where the Republicans have time after time continued to stall or prevent or ask really strange questions of the nominees. And they won't even show up to ask him questions, let alone have the vote.
And do you think Islamophobia, anti-Muslim animus, has a lot to do with this? A list of faith groups came out in support of Sayed, and they said anti-Muslim animus was driving this unprecedented action against him. We're, of course, also seeing right now from the GOP openly bigoted rhetoric being hurled at Democratic Congresswoman Ilhan Omar, who is Muslim. Is this all part and parcel of the same brazen Islamophobia?
I think it is. I think overall, it's a whole push against all of the nominees of color, not just those who are Islamic. But you definitely see this is very consistent among, the Republican attacks, in particular against those who are Muslims.
This story, of course, Senator, isn't just about Muslims in America. It's part of a larger issue we're dealing with in a post-Trump America where anti-immigrant, anti-minority sentiment seems to have become much more mainstreamed and more violent. Earlier this year, we saw the tragic shootings at the spas in the Atlanta area targeting members of the Asian American community. You were a co-sponsor of the anti-hate crime bill that Biden signed into law in May. It's supposed to make reporting hate crimes easier at the state and local level. How do you think we as a country are handling this issue?
Well, I'm glad that my piece of legislation, the anti-Asian hate crime bill, is actually anti-hate crime against all groups, passed. So I think that's a good thing that we've done. I think it's great that President Biden is nominating persons of color to all of these top leadership posts, whether it's over at HUD or Interior or Small Business Administration, as in the case of Ms. Sayed. But frankly, there's a sizable population that listens to Donald Trump. And remember that Donald Trump began his presidency by barring people from Muslim countries. That was not that long ago, and it only got worse with him leading the effort with very racist rhetoric all throughout his presidency. And now you see it showing up on the Senate floor, which is very sad because we should be doing the people's work. And this is not in keeping with what the Senate is about at all.
Yes, turning up on the Senate floor. Anyone who thought racism would be gone when Donald Trump left the White House, it seems to have become even worse. And talking of the Senate floor, I have to ask, the Senate, including Mitch McConnell, effectively voted today to break the filibuster to help move a bill forward that would allow the U.S. to raise the debt ceiling. A piece of legislation was proposed to allow a fast-track process for the Senate to vote on that debt ceiling bill for one time and one time only with a simple majority. So if you can bypass the filibuster to raise the debt ceiling, why can't you bypass the filibuster one time only to get voting rights passed, the most important issue of our lifetime?
Well, because it took the agreement of the Republicans to allow us to do that, and they won't agree to allow us to change and, to pass voting rights legislation, because they like all of these pieces of these laws at the state level that are meant to prevent, in particular, persons of color from being able to vote. So it would take them working with Democrats in order to pass voting rights legislation, which, by the way, not too long ago, a majority of Republicans supported. And now what you see is a real effort to move us towards the days when you're going to have to tell people how many jelly beans are in the jar before you get to vote. We can still restore the filibuster to what it was, such as a talking filibuster. So we can still change the rules. It's just going to take a little bit longer, and we're going to have to do more effort, and we're going to have to convince a couple of Democrats who right now are to do it.
We're almost out of time, and I have to ask, are you going to convince, I've asked so many senators on this show this question, are you going to convince Joe Manchin to change his mind on this? I mean, yesterday he voted with Republicans to, overturn a vaccine mandate that the Biden administration relies on. He seems to be getting worse, not better, when it comes to kind of voting with your party.
Well, he said that he opposes ending the filibuster, but he has said he's open to reforming it, which would be the talking filibuster. So I think there's still a chance there. We can't give up.
No, I know. We're running out of time, though. But appreciate you taking time out tonight. Senator Tammy Duckworth, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Still ahead, if there was a media figure on the right who could, in one single statement, manage to be misogynistic, anti-science, and denigrate Trump, too, who do you think that person might be? I'll give you a hint. Their name rhymes with Sucker Parson. Back with the details in 60 seconds. Two of the most reactionary and ridiculous right-wingers in transatlantic politics came together in person this week. Fox's white supremacy enabler-in-chief, Tucker Carlson, and the far-right British mastermind behind Brexit, Nigel Farage. Carlson was interviewing Farage on his Fox Nation streaming show and was asking him about embattled conservative British Prime Minister Boris Johnson.
We've seen more U-turns in policy from the Johnson government than I've seen in any government in my lifetime.
Yes.
And
in a very embarrassing way.
Oh, some of it's been shocking.
So somebody who knows him told me, and I should be interested in getting your take on this, that getting COVID emasculated him. It changed him. It feminized him. It weakened him as a man. Do you think that's...
Well, I think he was very seriously ill.
Oh, for sure he was.
And I think... I mean, one of the things we have learned from COVID is people who are 50, 60, 70, 80 pounds overweight tend to have fared very badly.
Sure.
Now, we don't talk about it
much.
But
the virus itself, this is true, does tend to take away the life force in some people, I notice. I mean, it does feminize people. No one ever says that, but it's true.
No one ever says that because it's bonkers, because it's blatantly, obviously, clearly not true. It's unhinged, misogynistic nonsense. COVID feminizes you. You lose your life essence, which is apparently only masculine. There are so many things wrong with that statement, aside from the brazen sexism and the idiocy. I mean, think about it. If they really believe all that misogynistic, unscientific nonsense, does that mean that their hero, Donald Trump, who also got COVID really bad, got hospitalized with COVID, does that mean he lost his life essence too? He got feminized? Is that the kind of attack lines we're going to see against the Donald come 2024 in the GOP primaries? No? I didn't think so. But also, I have to ask, Nigel Farage and Tucker Carlson are pontificating on this of all issues? Farage and Carlson? Do they look like paragons, icons of masculinity to you? Really? coming up next. It's called The Experiment, and more often than not, experiments fail, don't they? So why are so many people, including, it seems, the White House, pretending as if US democracy isn't under dire threat right now? Back after this.
Doesn't happen by accident. We have to renew it with each generation. And this is an urgent matter.
Yes. Yes. 1,000 times yes. That was President Joe Biden sounding the alarm at the White House today about global democracy at risk. And not a moment too soon, because you know what they say about political activism. Think global, act local.
In my view, this is the defining challenge of our time. Democracy, government of the people, by the people, for the people, can at times be fragile, but it also is inherently resilient. It's capable of self-correction, and it's capable of self-improvement.
I hope DC's Politics and Prose bookstore has a good section on democracy self-improvement, because the president needs to get down there ASAP and start browsing the book stacks. I mean, we keep warning that for Donald Trump, the January 6th attack on the Capitol was practice. Another assault on American democracy is underway right now. Top aides and allies to Trump continue to fight the investigation into the events that led to the attack. 19 states have enacted new laws this year that will make it harder to vote. 19. And the Republican effort to undermine voting rights isn't anywhere near over yet. There's also blatant gerrymandering in the wake of the 2020 census that will all but ensure a Republican victory in the House that is not representative of the will of the people. And don't get me started on the Senate. It's madness over there. So please, please, Mr. President, tell us what you're planning to do about it. We're all ears.
My administration is going to keep fighting to pass two critical pieces of legislation that will shore up the very foundation of American democracy, the sacred right of every person to make their voice heard through free, fair, and secure elections.
I'm sorry, what was that? You're going to keep fighting? Is this president laboring under the misapprehension that what his administration has done so far counts as fighting? That it's even sufficient? As I've already reported on this show this week, because the president is correct that there isn't a more urgent issue facing the nation, but we are almost a year into his first term in office and not a single piece of voting rights legislation has been passed. Not a single one. The For the People Act, the Freedom to Vote Act, the John Lewis Act, all blocked by Republicans in the Senate, all by using a filibuster that plenty of Senate Democrats still support. How can the president of these less than United States speechify to other world leaders about backsliding democracies going unchecked? A list that the US is on for the very first time, by the way, backsliding democracies. How can he do that and not seem to ramp up the campaign of what he's ready to do here at home to save democracy?
Faith in ourselves and in our democracies and in each other. That's what this summit is about. I'm so looking forward to a productive session and discussions that we'll have over the next 2 days. I'm looking forward to the connections we'll build to support our work moving forward. So let's get to work.
Come on, Joe. Summits are not the answer. They are window dressing, same as the gingerbread house in the state dining room and the more than 36 Christmas trees deployed throughout the White House right now. Look, who does a recent American citizen have to call to actually get something done to save US democracy? Santa Claus? Joining me now is Jason Stanley, professor of philosophy at Yale and the author of How Fascism Works. Jason, thanks for coming back on the show tonight. Joe Biden called this summit. He sounded the alarm. But let's start by asking a very blunt question. Is the United States really in a place to be lecturing other countries about democracy right now?
Well, we're all hypocrites because we all, in a system of injustice, all of us benefit from undemocratic institutions, private universities, private media. So there's hypocrisy here when the United States is under really an existential threat, not just from the electoral laws, but the attacks on our education system, which will result in less informed voters, and the protest laws. 45 states have considered 230 bills regulating protest. 36 of them have been enacted. These are bills that you have to think of in tandem with the attack on the electoral system, because they're preparing us for the protests that would greet the stealing of an election. So you have this very open anti-democratic movement happening, funded also by the oil companies. Many of these anti-protest bills restrict protests and illegalize protests near pipelines. So it's all happening at once, this structure of big oil companies, support many different business interests that are threatened by democracy, whose work is against the public good,
and yet
pushing this along with this movement.
And yet the president doesn't seem to be doing much about it. Washington Post columnist Jennifer Rubin notes that Joe Biden today said failure on voting rights is not an option, but then he avoided any remarks on the filibuster. How can Biden say that he's doing anything in regards to voting rights and preserving democracy if he continually refuses to engage in the debate over the filibuster?
He simply must. But one wonders what's going on behind the scenes. For instance, Senator Manchin. I think that the Republicans have kind of left him alone. If there were any sign at all that Senator Manchin would support these voting rights bills, I assume they would target him. So I think something is going on there. You can see this systematic attack happening. You can't just isolate one part. It's so massive. The attack on the education system, so that when there are protests, Americans won't understand their cause and will call for ever more violent police reaction. The attack on protests, the gerrymandering, all of this. And we're a very young democracy anyway. We've only became arguably a somewhat more complete democracy in the 1960s. So we're a very young democracy and a fragile democracy. And what you're seeing is that fragility being severely tested.
When we look at American democracy, some of its many flaws predate Trump. It's very easy to say it's about Trump and the Republicans and what state parties are doing. But a lot of the flaws, they are baked into the system, to the Constitution, to the way we do things for decades. Things like the Electoral College or a anti-majoritarian Senate, or the fact that politicians can draw their own districts and blatantly gerrymander. I mean, Biden's sitting with a bunch of Western democracies. In no other Western democracy do I know of politicians being able to draw their own boundaries in the way that they do here in the United States. There are broader institutional problems with American democracy, are there not?
We have systems. We're nowhere near a democracy, because what democracy would have one party win the popular vote in 7 out of 8 presidential elections and lose most of those elections? So we're not a democracy. The Senate empowers states with very few residents. So the Supreme Court has been acting undemocratically. Now, one thing one has to realize is if you want to topple a democracy, you take over the courts. It's the first thing you do. And so we have a court takeover. The results of the court takeover we've been seeing for many years, when the Voting Rights Act, key provisions of the Voting Rights Act were struck down, and a number of other anti-democratic measures. We see in real time why the courts are so important. You target democracy, you take over the courts and the schools, so you have an uninformed citizenry. And what we're seeing is the fruits of that, the multi-year fruits of that. So we also have to pay attention to what we're going to do about a Supreme Court that has been stacked with conservatives, despite the fact that Donald Trump lost the popular vote by 3 million in 2016.
A lot of what you're describing, Jason, seems to have taken place in Hungary, as you and I have discussed before. The stacking of the courts, the takeover of the media, the takeover of universities, this kind of illiberal democracy, what Orbán rather generously calls his own system. Hungary was not invited to participate in this global democracy summit today by the White House. He was a cherished visitor to the White House under Trump. What did you make of the decision not to invite Orbán to this gathering?
That would have been completely absurd to invite Orbán. I mean, 90% of the media in Hungary is in some way, shape, or form government controlled. You have the courts dominated by Orbán's lackeys. Hungary is a country where most of the citizens only speak Hungarian, so taking over the media really is powerful there. So a democracy is not just the majority votes. I mean, if, you know, the majority of Russians would vote for Putin, when you have a lack of information, when you have a lack of options, when you have the relentless vilification of opponents and the manufacturing of fake opponents like critical race theory to create fear and panic. you're not going to have a democratic system. I mean, North Koreans would vote for their leader again and again. So so you can't invite Hungary. And we still have a vibrant free press.
It's called the Democratic People's Republic of Korea for a reason, Jason. You said it would be ridiculous and absurd if Orban had been invited and Hungary had a seat at the table. And yet India under Modi and Brazil under Bolsonaro were invited, despite their own authoritarian, illiberal, anti-democratic tendencies. Some might argue that Modi has been far more authoritarian than even Orban.
Yeah, so we live at a time where two of the world's largest democracies are run by far-right, ultra-nationalist leaders. Bolsonaro openly talks about military dictatorship. The only thing stopping Bolsonaro from military dictatorship is the military, who are like, not really. But that is obviously fragile. So he's extremely explicit. Modi has been targeting journalists, academics, the free press. All of that is under massive attack. In the case of India, you have something similar to the United States, where you have a dominant majority having their ethnic nationalism stoked and being told that the minority groups, in this case the Muslims, are an existential threat to their culture. Just as here we're told that leftists and minorities
and yet they're given a pass by the White House.
Yeah, I mean, I think the White House is giving itself a pass. I mean,
Let's we're out of time. Let's end the interview by quoting you at the start of it. We're all hypocrites. Jason Stanley, thank you for your time tonight. I always appreciate it. When we come back, the list of what America's kids are in danger of not being taught is growing all the time, and it's growing more ridiculous too. And in a related point, does anyone here have a dictionary I can borrow? We're going to need it right after this. Don't go away. Why was Matthew Horn fired after a 16-year teaching career in Sullivan County, Tennessee? It's as simple as it is depressing. He talked about race. Never mind that the class he was teaching was titled Contemporary Issues, and the lesson that got him in trouble happened just weeks after the death of George Floyd and the shooting of Jacob Blake. Horn was speaking to the class about Blake, the unarmed black man in Kenosha, Wisconsin, who was shot and injured by the police. He compared the fates of Blake and Kyle Rittenhouse, who would later be cleared of wrongdoing by a jury after fatally shooting two people during demonstrations in Kenosha. Horn posed this thought to his nearly all-white classroom. White privilege is a fact. What we are going to do is we are going to discuss how we can help solve the issue of racism in America. What can we do here in Northeast Tennessee? I mean, he was teaching a class called Contemporary Issues. But for posing questions like that and assigning authors as dangerous as Ta-Nehisi Coates, Horn lost his job in May. That same month, Tennessee passed a law banning schools from teaching the idea that an individual, by virtue of the individual's race or sex, is inherently privileged, racist, sexist, or oppressive. And as we've told you on this show, conservative groups have already used this law to try banning books about Ruby Bridges and about Martin Luther King Jr. But this isn't just about Tennessee. This isn't just about Matthew Horn. This is about a nationwide attempt to censor, to crack down on any discussion of equality, race, and America's full history in the classroom. Don't take my word for it. Take the word of Wisconsin State Assembly member Chuck Wickers. He's trying to ban teachers from using specific words in the classroom. You want to know which words? Let's see how many I can squeeze in 60 seconds. Start the clock. Critical race theory, action civics, social emotional learning, diversity, equity, and inclusion, culturally responsive teaching, abolitionist teaching, affinity groups, anti-racism, anti-bias training, anti-blackness, anti-meritocracy, obtuse meritocracy, centering or decentering, collective guilt, colorism, conscious and unconscious bias, critical ethnic studies, critical pedagogy, critical self-awareness, critical self-reflection, cultural appropriation, misappropriation, cultural awareness, cultural competence, cultural proficiency, cultural relevance, cultural responsiveness, cultural responsive practices, decentering whiteness, deconstruct knowledges, diversity focus, diversity university training. Dominant discourses, educational justice, equitable, equity, examined systems, free radical therapy, free radical self-collective care, hegemony, identity, deconstruction, implicit, explicit bias, inclusivity, education, institutional bias, institutional oppression, internalized racial superiority, internalized racism, internalized white supremacy, interrupting racism, intersection, intersectionality, intersectional identity, intersectional studies, land acknowledgement, marginalized identities, marginalized, minoritized, underrepresented communities, microaggressions, multiculturalism, neo-segregation, normativity, oppressor versus oppressed, patriarchy, protect vulnerable identities, race essentialism, racial healing, racialized identity, racial justice, racial prejudice, racial sensitivity, training, racial supremacy. The list goes on and on and on. I couldn't even keep up there, as you saw. Here's a few of the big doozies I missed, couldn't get to. Social justice, systemic racism, whiteness, and of course, woke. They're all on the proposed banned list. When we come back, I'll be speaking to that fired Tennessee teacher about all of this. Don't go away. Joining us now is Matthew Horn, the former Tennessee social studies teacher who was fired from his job for teaching about white privilege. Mr. Horn, welcome to the show. Thanks so much for joining us tonight. Did you ever imagine that you would get fired over saying what you said, teaching what you taught?
Absolutely not. I've taught this class for a decade, and there has never been any issue. I'm a 16-year tenured teacher, and I have never had any complaints up until now.
So why do you think it happened now?
I mean, I think there is, a political divide that we are all experiencing that I have tried to keep out of my class. I think that, as we can see with these bills being passed, that people are looking to get into the classroom and get into education and kind of control what we are trying to do. And I think it's sort of maybe a misunderstanding of how my class operates. Look, in my class, I just teach kids to understand perspectives. That's it. I don't teach them what to think. I teach them how to think.
What have you been hearing from students and from fellow teachers and from parents of those students since all this happened?
Oh, man. Fortunately, I've had 16 years of being in the same school and in the same community, and the support I have received has been so overwhelming. Like, it's been, my former students have been so supportive. My community members have been so supportive. My family has been supportive. My friends have been supportive. Former parents or parents of former students have been supportive. And, I'm just eternally grateful to them, because this is extremely difficult. My livelihood was taken away. And, I'm not really sure what my place in the world is. If I'm not a teacher, then, what am I doing? It's something I've dedicated my life to. So I'm very grateful to the support.
So just to circle back to my opening question, this came out of the blue. It's not as if you were seeing, oh, wow, there's moves afoot in this school. I'm noticing a more, a growing climate of censorship. I better be careful what I say. You didn't have any of that. This came out of the blue.
Yeah, it came out of the blue. This is something, unfortunately, racial injustice and racial equity is a contemporary issue, and it has been for 400 years. And I've taught this for 10 years. And so I'm puzzled as to why I'm here. I have had a reputation of bringing students perspectives that they don't typically get to hear. My school is 96% white. I live in a community that's 95% white. So I'm doing what the state of Tennessee asked me to do and giving my students varying viewpoints.
So I want to play for you what is now a notorious example out of Texas of teachers this year being so fearful of breaking new laws there that they're willing to teach both sides of a subject that doesn't even have two sides. Have a listen.
Make sure that if you have a book on the Holocaust, that you have one that has opposing, that has other.
How do you oppose the Holocaust?
Believe me, that's come up.
Believe me, that's come up. People demanding differing perspectives on the Holocaust. I do have to ask, is there now a climate of fear amongst teachers in American schools? What have the conversations been like between you and your colleagues or former colleagues?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I've heard from teachers all across the country, not only about the Holocaust, but, you know, something like the Salem witch trials in states where these bills have passed that, you know, we're not real sure, or they are not real sure how they're going to teach that kind of stuff. And, you know, in a democracy, the free flow of ideas, you know, is central and it's key. And what better place to have that that's in a school? And now you're telling us that, you know, we can't talk about things, or, you know, we can't bring these issues to our students. And, you know, I asked, you know, they were telling me that I need to show the opposite of white privilege. Well, what is that? You know, I never told my students that white privilege is a fact. I just asked them to look at it. That's it. And I asked them, okay, well, if I have to teach the opposite of white privilege, do I have to teach the opposite of the Holocaust? Do I have to say that the Holocaust didn't happen? Do we have to say that the earth is flat? You know, that doesn't make any sense.
What is the opposite of white privilege is a great question. Yeah. I have to ask, there is an irony, is there not, that the same political party that goes on about free speech has spent the last decade fear-mongering about threats to free speech in schools, on campuses, is now the same party that is openly, happily, enthusiastically policing speech inside of classrooms?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I don't understand that. And, you know, here in my community, there are a lot of conservative people who have reached out to me, and they have the same questions that you and I have. You know, what are we doing? You know, as a part of this community, there are still good people here, and they're still wondering the same thing. Like, why is it not okay to teach the truth about American history and to invite different perspectives from our kids to learn from?
What is your next step in this process? Are you trying to get your job back? Yeah. Are you taking legal action?
Yes. Well, because I'm a tenured teacher, the state of Tennessee affords us a three-step process. I am in phase two of that. I lost the first one, the first appeal in August. And the second step is an appeal in front of my Board of Education. If I don't like the outcome there, then I could possibly appeal it to Chancery Court. And so that's the third step. And so right now we're just waiting on it. My appeal to the Board of Education is on Tuesday, December the 14th.
It is crazy, crazy that this has happened, that you are a teacher who is being treated in this way because you're trying to teach your class about white privilege, as you said, teaching them not what to think, but how to think. I find the whole thing absurd. Matthew Horn, I appreciate you taking time out to join us this evening.